It's Matt Wasser, and I'm with Black Dog Pottery and here in Minnesota, beautiful West St. Paul, Minnesota. And I'm just doing a little video. I've got some handle pilsners that I'm going to be assembling. I just thought I'd do a little video of that and show everybody. They're thrown with about, exactly 1 3/4 pounds of clay. So these are a real stiff leather hard to the point where bottom I can leave a impression with my thumb, not so much at the top. Okay, so I have in a damp box, which you can see behind me there. Basically, it's got water at the bottom. And so I usually throw things in a 2-day cycle. I throw pieces and the next day I assemble. And I can kind of control the dampness from the damp box, that's the name. And this time of year, we're getting more moisture in the air, so things aren't drying out as fast. So I have a little bit more flexibility as far as when I can work on things. So, basically, the first thing I do is I'm going to smooth out the bottom. I got some water here. I'll show you my assembly here in a minute. But I'm wiping down the bottom, any sort of imperfections I'm smoothing over. And fingerprints. When I take them off the wheel, I usually dry my hands and then pull them right off. I don't do much with the bottoms. I have what a little high tech here. I'm going to use the Red Wing. An old tuna can. With a sponge in it, and I spray WD-40 into that. Now that then becomes impregnated with oil. Let's put this right now. And it lasts for quite a long time and contains the oil. And then I have other stamps and things like that. I've got my Black Dog Pottery stamp that I actually got back in the late 1990s. So that's fairly old. Kids that are younger than that. And I press that into, let me show you guys. I'll press that into the sponge, and then using the old axiom that oil and water don't mix, you've got water in the clay and oil on the stamp, and then it gives you a good impression. Okay. So I like metal stamps like that, and leather stamps work particularly nicely. And all sorts of stamping. I made 4 of these the other day, and in order for them to not dry out too much on the rim, but once they, because I didn't have a lot of time earlier today to work on them, so I basically just, once they got set up enough to work on, I turned them upside down on the board, and that way it traps the air. Normally what's going to happen is it's going to dry from the top down, from that rim down to the bottom, and so I'm retarding the drying process. Now if I was worried very much about them, I'd take my spray bottle and spray them with water, or I'd spray more water in the damp box as a whole, or cover them with even more plastic inside of the damp box. I've had to do that over the winter because stuff is drying out way too fast. So, so let's see, the next stage is, now I've wiped all the bottoms of those and smoothed them out. Next thing is I've got a serrated rib here. You can see that, there you go. And I use that to basically, I'm going to score and slip where the handles are going to go. So I do that because I'm trying to be as efficient as possible. I try to do a number of pieces at the same time. And when I'm done with these, once they're all assembled, I'm probably going to do some throwing in more of these. And then eventually my next on my agenda, once I have so many of those done, then I'm going to be moving on to goblets or some others. Things that we're going to sell at the restaurants. All right, so I've got a number of extruded handles. These are fairly thick slug out of the extruder. I don't get that many handles per bag of clay. So I'd say each of these is, I don't know, maybe 1/10 of a pound, something in that range, 1/8 of a pound. They're fairly thick. So that, and then 1 3/4 clay for the piece itself. So you're getting up there to 2 pounds of clay. So these are pretty hefty. And when they're fired, they're all going to shrink. And, back when I initially did the capacity test, I think they were in the range of about 28 to 32 inches, depending on how they're thrown. You know, how economical I am with my clay and my throwing. So, and the shape that I choose a little bit for them, shaping them. So I'm scoring the handles. I've smooshed down each end so they're going to fit. fit very nicely here. Let's move some to the side. Right. So next I have a brush here, and I've got some thicker slip. This actually has my handle slip. Even thicker. The handles will be not very thick because it's going to go on like paste basically and glue it into the piece. My medallion slip is thinner because that's what I put on the sides. I put these pressed medallions on the side with various sayings or details or whatever to add interest to the mug or tinker in this case. Well, that's a handle pilsner we call. We used to make pilsners a number of years ago. They were like the fourth item that we would sell in our booth. And eventually we needed something that was about 2 pounds of clay that we were selling at a certain price point. So I started making 2 pound tankards. And then I just, the pilsners by themselves didn't sell great. And then one day I just decided, well, what if I put a handle on that same shape? And then they've been selling ever since. So that's how we were making those. We used to make a different style tank stein. They held about the same amount. So there we are. Basically, it's been scored and slipped and attached. And it's all set for medallion. So I'm going to put that on the board here. Oh, I didn't put a pressing on this one. Usually that's my last step. I put it underneath the handle, like so. Now, I don't date my pieces because, I mean, that's something that people like to do. We'd like to be able to sell it the next year without any sort of prejudice against it, I guess, or just not any, you know, if people see something that's old, they'll think that maybe someone else passed it by, and it's mostly just that it maybe got on the shelf at the very end of the show, or wasn't displayed prominently. It doesn't mean the piece doesn't have merit of itself, so I'm not a real big fan of dating my work that way. It also would just remind me of how old I am, and I don't need any reminders of that. See, I've got a garage studio here, and my wife probably thinks I'm a little nutty for talking to myself. In this case, I'm talking to you, but it's on a video, so still. And it's a balmy 35 degrees today in here in Minnesota, so. And I fired a kiln out in the shed, and that's cooling down. It's about 550 degrees, so I'll open that tomorrow and see what I got out of that. I did a few new variations on things that I know work pretty well, but you know, you always kind of try it out, and if pieces don't work, then you judge them, and you say, well, maybe I can refire that or add another glaze to it, refire it. So there's that piece. So what I'm looking for is a good shape like so you can put your hand inside of it. On some pieces, I'll put a piece of clay here, basically to run your thumb into. These are pretty big, meaty handles that are hanging off quite a bit. I don't really need that. So. And I extrude a number of handles ahead of time, basically for what I'm planning on making. Sometimes they'll run out. And then what I do is I learned this trick from a friend of mine who worked at another studio, that you turn a clay bag inside out so it's clean, right? And it's going to be little clay bits you'll throw in the trash, whatnot. And that bag that you put the handles, let me show you, you pyramid the handles on the board. Let them dry out a little bit so they're not tacky. And then you pyramid them on a board like that. And then you cover the whole thing in a plastic bag. Cover it, and then I put it in my damp box to keep it extra from drying out too much. I found out by the hard way that my infrared heater in the garage here will, the heat will be transmitted through the bags, so if I had handles by the heater, it would dry out the handles. So that was a unpleasant way to find that out. But you know, clay, as long as it's not fired, you can always reuse it and repurpose it. So I could have, you know, I lost a few handles, not a big deal. If it was a lot, I would probably just dry them out fully, crush them down, and then reconstitute them with water and into a slurry, and then that slurry that I put on my plasterboard to dry out, and then reuse it and rethrow it or redo it, something with it, you know. Recyclable, right? Doesn't go bad. just gets moldy. So what you're seeing is I'm basically smoothing out the insides. That's gonna, so that you don't have any sharp points there and at the bottom. Sometimes I'll do this, I learned this trick from Bill Van Gilder's videos, he's a great potter. Basically I have a dowel, it's probably like a half inch, yeah, it's a half inch dowel. And sometimes I'll use that and I'll run that at the bottom and give me a nice roll right there. All right, this one's already stamped at the bottom, so we're good to go. See these handles, they have like small imperfections, no big air bubbles or anything like that, but just some small imperfections. You can, you know, basically that one had a small, let's see that, but it's a small air bubble right there. That little imperfection, I'm just going to take a little bit of clay, work it in, and then smooth it out with a sponge. A little sniffly between the allergies and this time of year. Snowpack, and then also things are starting to bloom. And just me, I don't know. Score and slip. And before I scored and slipped, I used to just put the handle down raw and worked all right, but I'd occasionally get them, if they dried too fast, they'd crack off. Create a weak spot there, so I've been scoring and slipping them for the number of years, basically. Not always necessary, it kind of depends on the clay, how you dry them, etc., but I don't know, so I always, I mean, these are going to be bought by the general public for everyday use, hopefully, and so I don't want to create anything that has any weaknesses if I can help it, and so try to make them as durable as possible. Alright, so I'm going to change the that one, and that angle I don't like so much, so that's better. I like that. Okay, so that one's done. Now, so these are all set. I'm gonna wrap the rest of my handles and then get dried out. What is it? At the start of any session and the end of any session, we're working on clay, you're gonna have prep work, all right, and cleanup work. Part of the deal. Alright, the next thing I'm going to do, I'm going to take my serrated rib and I'm going to run medallions. Let me see what type of medallions I'm going to put on them. I've got these pressed out ahead of time. Usually on days when no one's around, I will press using my hydraulic press. And so I've got a Tree of Life and some of my Celtic Dragons. We have plaster molds of. I'll put those on. So, I've got a whole box basically with medallions that I pressed out ahead of time, so I don't have to stop, right? You know, that's always your death to any production. So these I'm going to score where the line's going to go, cross hatch with the serrated rib, and you don't need the whole area, just the majority of it. You want to, it'll ensure adhesion between the medallion and the two pieces, and then also you can let them dry a little slowly so that they moisture, if there's any moisture differential between the pieces, it will even out. So it's a little more challenging when you're in high production mode or high heat mode around here, which only lasts maybe a couple weeks here and there over the summer. Otherwise it's cold and dry. Alright, so now like I said, I'm going to switch my slips. I got two different containers of slip. The other one here is a nine slip. Okay. Handle slip is thicker. That's it. So now I've scored my piece, scored my medallion. Okay. And I take this and put a little slip. Now this is, slip is basically just the same clay that I take my throwing bucket, but it varies consistencies, and I take a hand mixer to it, like a KitchenAid, not a KitchenAid, but like a kitchen mixer type of deal, so little white ones. And just run it in there to get the consistency even. Once in a while, I just add some more clay and mix it up and smooth it out like a mold shake. So what I did basically there is I just adhered it, the slip, and I can see it's coming around the sides. And then I'm going to check the front for any little imperfections or fingerprints, and I'm going to smooth those out. And lastly, I take my sponge, my wet sponge, and I'm going to run this around the sides and get that extra slip off. Now the last thing I do, once I'm done doing an entire board, and I've only got four pieces here, so they go pretty fast. But I'll show it to you here before I'm not going to do all four of them for you at this point. So the next thing we're going to do, the last thing we're going to do, before I put them in my damp box to dry, I'm going to check to make sure there's any problems with them or anything I don't like. I don't know, that handle's a little big for this shape. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to bring it up a little bit. Okay? When you bring it up, it brings the whole shape in. Pulls the whole shape in. Right? And it'll change that curve. So it's now a little bit more of a more upper tip curve. So the last thing I do is I have a real high-tech thing. And this is from Bill Van Gelder, too. But he makes one out of clay that's glazed and it's conical. I have, high-tech, a Diet Pepsi bottle. Okay? Half filled with water, not entirely, so I can grip it. All right? But it's got a lot of weight to it because it's got water in it. I don't think I'd ever want to see what's in the water at this point. It's been in my studio for a few years. And the last thing I do is I put it in the top. Okay, and the weight of that, as long as it's still a little malleable, the weight of that's going to re-round the pot. Okay, now it may have some memory of all the things I've done to it, or if there's a big medallion on it that's going to maybe pull it during the firing process. Because clay has memory, but it should keep it roughly around, and I've had much more success doing that than anything else. So again, Bill Van Gelder, clay god, thank you very much, and I'm going to work on the rest of these, and I'll throw some more pots. So anyway, have a good day. Cheers.